So after the earthquake in Christchurch, we began a series of surveys using geophysical techniques to try and understand the subsurface geology of the region. We're doing these surveys because they will help us to potentially find new faults in the region or better map the faults that we already know are there. Geophysics is understanding the earth through the physical properties of the rocks. So each survey in itself gives a little bit of information, but when they're all joined together, it gives us a lot more information that allow us to interpret the geology in a lot more detail. Okay, the seismic survey is done by putting seismic waves into the ground, and we do that with a seismic source. In the case of Canterbury, they're using what's called a vibrosized truck, which has got a big foot on it that it shakes the ground. The seismic source creates a small earthquake. If you're really close to it, you can actually feel the ground move. And that is, seismic waves travel down into the earth, they're reflected off various rock layers and come up and are recorded on what are called geophones, which are very sensitive microphones that are spaced out around the track. The seismic profile gives quite a high resolution picture compared to the other surveys we're doing, and it shows the layers of rock and any offsets by faults or other geological structures in the subsurface. Seismic surveys are done along lines, and so we get profiles of the subsurface. We use our other surveys, the gravity and magnetic surveys, to have a more regional view. So a gravity survey is really useful because it's a very portable instrument. You can travel around to all sorts of areas in rugged terrain or down central Christchurch. It's a passive instrument. It doesn't actually cause any vibrations in the ground. Over a period of several days, we can cover a lot of ground, get our measurements very quickly, and keep moving on in the survey. The critical thing about gravity is that it changes with height. The further away you get from the centre of the Earth, the lighter you get. So we've got to have fairly accurate heights to get fairly accurate gravity measurements. And that's what we use the GPS for. So Jai Shun will be measuring there for 5 minutes or more to get a really accurate measurement of height. 2, 2, 2, 3. And out this way, I'd say another 2 meters. We're estimating the terrain around the gravity station because, as you can imagine, if you had a great high hill beside the gravity meter, it has a gravity effect. Or if you have a great big valley beside the gravity meter, it also has a similar effect. The number is 3938.462. So this helicopter has a magnetic instrument in it that measures the Earth's magnetic field and also the magnetic properties of the rock beneath the helicopter as it traverses over the area. Inside the helicopter is an instrument that continually records the magnetic signal. The sensor is out in front of the helicopter on the long pole, keeping it away from any magnetic material that's inside the helicopter. All the steel and iron in the helicopter will have a magnetic signature, so you want to reduce the effect of that by keeping the sensor as far away from all that metal as possible. So once the helicopter is taken off, it starts on a grid pattern that are flying backwards and forwards over the survey area. The lines are about 400 meters apart, and it's flying at an elevation of between 100 and 300 meters. All these surveys are then put together and compiled, and the power of the process is by looking at them overlaid with each other on geographic systems like this. The map here shows you the gravity anomalies in the Christchurch region. This is the Littleton Harbour area. The dark red colours here relate to the dense volcanic rocks in the region, and so they have a positive gravity. As we go further here to the north and west, we go into the bluer region, which is a lower gravity, and this relates to the less dense sediments in the Canterbury Plains. In our interpretation of these data, we look at the way the density distribution of the rock reflects the shape of structures beneath the Canterbury Plains. So over on the right, we have very preliminary data from our aeromagnetic survey. So it's still just basically raw data off the aeroplane. But you can see here there are magnetic anomalies all over the map here. This region here is sort of the Port Hills area again, and into the Christchurch city here, north of Christchurch in this direction. And we look at these anomalies to see if we can see lineations that could be related to faults. This is a gravity map that shows you the gravity anomalies in the region. We have the coast overlaid here, and I can overlay the earthquakes that have been recorded in the region since September last year. So we can then correlate those earthquake locations with the structures that we see in the geophysical data. So we have to be careful in the way that we interpret this, because we're looking at a three-dimensional distribution of earthquakes on a two-dimensional map. So the earthquakes may actually be trending down at different angles, and it looks like there's a spread of them, but they may actually align in terms of depth along fault planes. This geophysical data is going to be combined with all the other information we have from the region, and it's going to help us to understand the geological history of the region better and interpret what the geological hazards could be. The people of Christchurch have been through a very significant earthquake, caused a lot of devastation. The data we've collected here, we hope will give the best possible information for the planning and rebuilding of Christchurch.